Last time on
Danganronpa.
No, the differences are bigger than that, I think.
Come on! I'm not smart enough to think of trying to change my handwriting anyway.
So Makoto, are you saying you don't think Hiro's the culprit?
And he is not the only one. I think Hiro's innocent as well. Then there can be no doubt. Hiro is the prime suspect.
Well, he can't bend at the waist. Seems like a pretty obvious oversight. Yeah, the whole note.
I knew it. It fits perfectly with the note we found hidden on Hifumi.
Then Taka's scrap and Hifumi's note.
No, they're from the same piece of paper.
Sounds like it just as
Thank you.
Since there were two murders, it's at least plausible that more than one person was involved.
What do you mean?
If there'd only been one murder, then yes, the idea of an accomplice isn't really worth considering. Naturally, if only one person can be saved per murder, an accomplice has no risk versus reward benefit.
Risk versus reward benefit?
The payoff for working together. The reward that balances out the risk of taking part in a scheme. There's no point in being someone's accomplice if there's no benefit to you. However, if there were some potential mutual reward for the risk, then cooperation becomes possible.
You're saying that two people could act as each other's accomplices to commit two separate murders?
I think that's what the true killer told Hifumi. They would each have an accomplice for their crime. And based on the case's events, Hifumi would have been the first one to act, murdering Taka. They made him carry out the first murder so he couldn't back out of helping them later on.
So in this case, there wasn't one single person committing multiple murders. Instead, each person killed someone, creating two separate incidents. And it only looked like one person because that's how the true killer designed it to look. A single suspicious individual, a similar weapon used in each crime, disappearing bodies. By creating one seamless set of circumstances, they made it look like one person was behind it all.
The mastermind picked their target and managed to convince him to go along with their plan. And then, to avoid the no accomplices rule, they simply killed their accomplice. Which, if true, means that betraying Hifumi was part of the plan from the very beginning.
That's just awful! How could anyone be so cruel?
You think so? I can't help but admire its cunning. Still, their choice of accomplice seems odd.
The effort made to convince us two murders are the same. The main characteristic this time... Yo must have noticed that fact from the very beginning. His wife said not to look at a series of connected events, but entirely separate incidents. Kyo is really amazing, although, when you think about it, she's almost too amazing. Like, it's almost unnatural how good she is at this.
I understand how an accomplice could be involved, but then who was the one pulling Hifumi's strings?
Problem numero uno right now!
The true killer manipulated Hifumi to carry out a number of actions and in the end, murdered him. In the debates until now, the way the case has unfolded when you consider all that, there's still really only one person who seems to fit! And I hate to say it. I really don't want to. I really don't.
Here's my answer. It was Celeste.
So I'm the suspicious individual now, am I? I really do hate this kind of joke.
A joke? I wonder.
So what you are saying, then, is that I specifically chose to work together with Hifumi. The idea that I would choose to spend any amount of time interacting with him... That I would go within 10 feet of that shit for brains, that lazy, worthless, goddamn idiot! Pardonnez-moi.
Just to be clear, there is evidence to support it.
Is that so?
It is. The investigation, there was certain behavior that was common only to the two of you. Considering what we've learned so far, it only further proves that the two of you were working together.
What is it that only Hifumi and Celeste had in common? The screaming. No wait, encountering a suspicious individual.
The behavior they had in common has to do with the suspicious individual in the suit, doesn't it? The only ones who ever actually saw Robo Justice firsthand were Celeste and Hifumi.
Shush, the adults are talking now.
Sorry.
As he said, only Celeste and Hifumi ever laid eyes on the costumed individual. If we accept that Hifumi was one of the culprits, we can't help but suspect what Celeste has said as well.
Are you saying everything they told us was a lie?
After taking Hifumi to the nurse's office, we all began our search for this individual, correct? And not too long after that, do you remember what Celeste said?
I saw a shadow, something moving around at the top of the stairs.
We headed to the second floor specifically because of what she claimed to have seen. Next, to draw us all to the physics lab up on the third floor,
she let out a blood-curdling scream.
And when we'd all come to see what was wrong, what was it she said?
Celeste, what's wrong? That was a rather intense scream for someone like you. I saw him, the strange costume man. He ran off as soon as I screamed. I was blocking the stairs, so he headed further down into the hallway and disappeared.
Once she'd done her job of getting us all up to the physics lab, it was time for her partner to get to work.
Yeah! Huh? What was that? That came from downstairs. It must have been... Ifumi, he's in the nurse's office! This is bad. Come on, we have to go back.
It was to get us to divide into two groups. So that we would discover both bodies at the same time?
In fact, Celeste was precisely the one who proposed that we split up.
Now, why don't we split up into two groups? I'll lead the hunting party. That seems much more interesting. Very well. Makoto and Hina, you come with me to the nurse's office. I'll lead the catch of the suspicious individual, the Toko, Pyakia, and Sakura.
Well, if Celeste and Hifumi were working together, all those chance events suddenly become connected. And on top of that, that piercing cry of yours early on. That was to signal Hifumi, wasn't it? It was your way of telling him, we are on the third floor, everything's going according to plan. Why else would you let out a scream that could have carried across the sea?
I just realized another strange thing. When we found Hifumi in the nurse's office, who we now know was only pretending to be dead.
I certainly was not expecting this. I did not imagine that Hifumi would be murdered.
Celeste, you were the first one to say he'd been murdered. You wanted to make sure we wouldn't have any doubt in our minds.
I don't believe it. Everything. The whole thing was one big act.
Hina, you were with Celeste when Hifumi's body disappeared, right?
Yeah. I was feeling kind of sick, so Celeste took me to the bathroom. Wait! Then that was...
She wasn't worried about you. She just saw a chance to help Hifumi sneak out of the nurse's office.
Each piece isn't much by itself, but start putting them together and the picture gets very ugly indeed. Wouldn't you agree, Celeste?
I have no idea what you mean.
Don't bother trying to deny it. You made one fatal mistake.
Oh, did I?
I didn't even catch it myself when you first said it, but... Looking back, I can say that that one little slip-up was your undoing.
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about what you said after Hifumi's body disappeared and we returned to the nurse's office.
You must really be enjoying this. Enjoying the sight of us standing around, frightened and confused. We're all going to die here. We're going to die just like those guys did!
I remember her saying that too. but I don't understand what's so strange about it.
Then pay attention. Sakura, Toko, and I were first to discover Taka's body in the equipment room. Then Makoto showed up and told us Hifumi had been killed, so Sakura and I left with Makoto. Once we were in the hall, we ran into Celeste, and the four of us headed to the nurse's office. Now, the entire time we were together, none of us said anything about Taka being dead. Think about it. Celeste's comment doesn't make sense. It was completely out of place.
Yeah, I see what you're talking about. Although I don't really get what it means.
You hear that, Celeste? Everyone's having some trouble understanding. Could you repeat what you said? If you're really not the culprit, you shouldn't have any problem repeating it, right?
Yaka said that Celeste's comment doesn't make sense. But what's he alluding to? Make your argument! Monokuma file number 3!
All I said was... they must really be enjoying this. Enjoying the sight of us standing around, frightened and confused. They must be positively elated. We are all going to die here. We are going to die, just like those guys died. And that is all I said.
And that's all it takes to finish this. It's obvious, isn't it?
What was so strange about Celeste's comment?
Let me pick that up. When she said that, she should have only known about Hifumi's death. Never mind, what's so strange about what she said is... that she knows that there's two!
Said what?
She knew about it!
Enjoying the
sight. That was her night!
We are all going to die! We are going to die! Just
you
like
jerk!
Bang!
No, that's wrong.
See, you boot me on the side and treat me like this.
That's right. There's no reason Celeste should have said, just like those guys died. When she said that, none of us had told her Taka was dead.
Exactly. And we didn't run into her until after we were all out in the hall. So there was never any chance for her to have seen his body in the equipment room for herself.
So how did you know, Celeste? How did you know more than one person had been killed? And how did you know they were both guys? Because Kyoko had also disappeared, right? So she could have been dead, too.
You all have such vivid imaginations. You know that?
Imaginations?
You claim that I was lying when I told you about the suspicious person I saw. Then what about the picture I took? How do you explain this picture of the costumed villain dragging Hifumi away?
It has to be some kind of setup, right? So let's put the suit on, and then she used the camera's timer to set up the picture.
Have you so quickly forgotten? You are the only one who could have possibly fit into that suit. Plus, I happen to know that this particular camera does not have a timer. In other words, it is an unassailable fact that this is a picture of Hifumi being dragged away. If everything I told you was a lie, how can this picture exist?
Simple. Are we sure that's really a picture of the suspect dragging Hifumi away?
What could you possibly mean by that?
Surely there are other explanations than the one you've offered up.
No. There is no other explanation.
Other explanations? If it was a picture of the suspect dragging Hifumi away, the only other possibility is Hifumi's dragging the suspect away.
It's not a picture of the suspect dragging Hifumi away. I would say it's a picture of Hifumi dragging the suspect away.
That's certainly within the realm of possibility. The one being dragged off in that picture isn't Hifumi, but the person in the robot suit. We've simply been led to believe that it's the other way around. And the strange costume might only exist to lead us astray even farther. If you saw someone wearing something like that in this situation, of course you'd notice and be suspicious.
That's what happened! You put me to sleep and made me out to be the bad guy in all this!
Such a thing is utterly impossible. Hifumi was dragging him away? Ridiculous.
Is it? I don't think it's ridiculous at all.
Then shut your mouth and allow me to educate you.
So this thinks she can prove that there is no way Hifumi was dragging the suspect away. But is that really possible? Make your argument! Robo Justice costume, yes, hear a message, and Robo Justice blueprints.
You dressed me up in that suit after I passed out. Then you just draped me across Hifumi and had him carry my weight. You tried to make me look like the bad guy.
Like I said, ridiculous. As you can see in the picture, the suspect is standing perfectly upright. If the person inside the suit was unconscious, there's no way they could stand up straight like that.
Then the fortune-telling idiot is the culprit after all!
No way!
If I remember right, Hina said, he said that she couldn't bend at the waist.
You dressed me up in that suit after I passed out. Then you just draped me across Hifumi and had him. You tried to make me look like the bad guy.
Like I said, ridiculous. As you can see in the picture, the suspect is standing perfectly upright. If the person inside the suit was unconscious, there's no way they could stand up straight like that.
Boom!
No, that's wrong. No. Even if the person inside the suit were unconscious, they could still stand up like that. Because that Robo Justice suit had a certain characteristic.
Totally can't bend the waist. Seems like a pretty obvious oversight.
That's right! They totally made a mistake when they made it, so it couldn't bend at the waist.
I'm not so sure that was a mistake. I think the suit was designed from the beginning to be used the way it was.
Celeste and Hifumi took the suit they'd specially designed and stuffed Hiro into it. That's how they were able to fake that whole thing. The point of it all was to make us believe whoever was in the suit was to blame.
Well then, I suppose this is checkmate.
Checkmate?
Don't make me laugh, you idiot! What do you mean, checkmate?
Celeste?
Clearly, you want to cram me into your little guilty box. Well, there's one little problem. Have you already forgotten what Hifumi told us as he lay dying?
Hifumi, who was it? Who attacked you? Who tried to kill you? Who killed me? That's right. I remember their name. Yasuhiro.
When we asked him who had attacked him, his answer was quite clear, was it not? He said, and I quote, Yasuhiro.
In other words, Yasuhiro Hagakure!
Wait, but my name isn't really Yasuhiro. It's actually Taro.
Your confusing statements don't make any sense. You're only making things more complicated.
He did say Yasuhiro, But are we sure he was really pointing the finger at Hiro?
What the hell are you talking about? I'll burn you alive!
Kyoko, what do you mean by that?
Think back to how Hifumi used to talk to us. How did he refer to each of us?
He said people's last names. Mr. Naegi, Miss Girigiri.
That's right. Our last names. He called us all by our last names.
Exactly. I know I heard him say Mr. Naegi more than once, for example. So if Hifumi did mean to say Hiro's name, he would have said his last name, Hagakure.
I'm sure it was just incidental. By chance, he just... his first name. Indecent?
Don't talk.
Random chance. Now isn't that a convenient explanation? No. There's no reason to think he would have said the name any different than normal. But he must have run out of energy before he could say any more.
So Hifumi was trying to tell us the last name of whoever killed him?
But the name he said doesn't apply to anyone here.
Well, no. Hold on. There's one person it could apply to. And that's Celeste. She never actually told us what her real name is.
What did you just say? To think you'd take your false accusation so far, I don't know whether to laugh or spit! Come on! Enough with your idiotic blather! Yasuhiro is a loser's name! Do I look like a loser to you? Well, do I? What? I think I've earned the right to be a little on edge.
Okay, then fill us in. What's your real name?
Fine! Make sure your ear holes are wide open and listen up! My real name is Celestia Lugenberg. Could you please stop making me repeat myself over and over again?
So I still won't give up. So then... I have to do something to make her accept it. Make your argument! E-Handbook's Bottle's Hammer and Yasuhiro's Message. I think I know what it is.
Hifumi was trying to tell us something. He wanted us to know the killer's last name. Yasuhiro.
If there's one person here who might have that last name...
It would have to be you, Celeste. You haven't told anyone what your real name is.
How many times do I have to tell you? My name is... Celestia Lugenberg, God damn it!
How long do you plan to go on pretending?
I'm not pretending. It's the truth. And since you have no way to contradict me, that's the only truth there is, moron!
But remember, there's something here that shows its owner's real name. I'm sure Kyoko mentioned it at some point. May not be related to the case, but it might come in handy anyway, and we all know what that is.
Hifumi was...
Even I knew it was when I saw the clues.
He wanted us to know the killer's last name. Yasuhiro.
If there's one person here who might have that last name...
It would have to be you, Celeste.
So, what do you guys think of this turnout? Did you guys notice the key pickup here? I hope you did, because I kinda did. Just sad that I just got her to max, now I have to kill her. Well, hopefully Kyoko won't die. Otherwise, I'm really gonna hate myself for the people I picked. That's one of those no endings, and BOOM! Got it. Well, let's just get to the ending climax already. I'll see you there.
That's it! The handbook!
What?!
Anytime you turn your handbook on, it shows the owner's name when it boots up, right? Monokuma told us all about it before.
This handbook is absolutely vital to a healthy school life, so don't lose it! When you start it up, it'll display your name. Always make sure you have the right one.
Now, this is not your everyday notebook, so it has so many more uses than that!
So all we have to do is check her handbook, and that'll clear up everything. That's how we can find out Celeste's real name.
That's an invasion of privacy. I refuse to cooperate.
Celeste, can you please just tell us what really happened? Please, just tell us.
Even when I'm put in check, it's just my nature not to give up. Because until the game's over, you never know what might happen.
Fine then. Let me settle it. Let me go over the case again, from the beginning, and shed light on all your crimes. And that'll bring everything to an end.
Closing argument, begin! Finish the thought! Oh boy, this is gonna be fun. In this case, how did the killer recruit their accomplice? Was it seduction? Can that be seduction? I don't really think it was. Oh, you can do the... It goes off the list? That's interesting. That might be a small glitch. Hero, your room broke the game! I know you guys probably already saw it. I saw it now in recap, what it is. And you can already tell I made a first mistake. What time did the killers call the victim to the rec room? That's an easy one. Remember, the watch isn't broken yet, so it's 6 o'clock. No, wait. The setup is for 1, not for 6. Blah. I just basically messed up, but I got it right in the game, so don't worry. So yeah, you know my first one's off, but we're still going. But what do you think of that turnaround, huh? What a case. And our guy kind of called it. He knew what they were. He knew that Taka and Ifumi were going to be the ones to die this chapter, and he called the killer. It makes sense that Celeste did it in this one. You can tell by their actions. I mean, I was reading it the whole time, and I just knew it was. And I feel kind of bad that I have to kill her, but... I'm still trying to think of who to get next. Should I go for the... Well, you know who. Idiot. I'm going to skip over that because I don't know which one it is offhand. But that was how I was supposed to have the equipment room? 6. But yeah. Did I just say that I was used to kill Taka? What number was it? We're in speed mode at the moment. Whoops! But yeah, you can tell that it was coming. I wasn't feeling good about it. I mean, this chapter just read like an open book. I'd like to give you so much time here. In the library, you feel me? You something to take the pit evidence of the fake criminal. But the existence of a shadowy criminal, thank you for redoing it past me. But yeah, just a shame that it had to be her. And I'm trying to... Oh yeah, when Jess Sam was in their sauce, what? How was used to deal the blow? Number 3. So I'm trying to say Byakuya or Hero. Because the others do have their in access moments. If we need something to move Taka's body. So I gotta pick between the two of them, see which one I want to use for the rest of the game. And that's all we're using for the rest of the game, I think. Unless something comes up where I can. The weapon the killer used to murder Hifumi, what was it? It was the spotless hammer. So now we just got 2 more. No, 1 more. Well, 1 more to place and to see if we're right, which I know we've already blown 1 at the moment. Right here.
So what did he use to knock him out and stuff him into the suit? Oh yeah, this, the camera. Ready?
The killer is you! Before anything, the killer persuaded someone to help carry out the murder. And that person was...
Nope, that was wrong. Oh well, I got 4 hearts left. So you know that one wasn't it. And yeah, I see now that it was this one because it makes sense. So let's do it again.
Exactly what happened. Before anything, the killer persuaded someone to help carry out the murder. And that person was... Kifumi. With an accomplice, the killer was able to execute a number of otherwise impossible schemes. First, they convinced someone to meet them in the rec room last night at 1 in the morning. That someone they met with was Hiro. The murderous duo intended to pass Hiro off as the prime suspect. So when they met up with him, they drugged him, knocked him out, and stuffed him into the Robo Justice suit. Next, Kifumi positioned himself to make it look like Robo Justice was attacking him, while the killer used a digital camera to take pictures of the assault. They did all this just to create evidence that would put the suspicion on Hiro. When they were done with him, they shoved him, still unconscious, into the pool room locker. And then finally, at 6 a.m., they moved into the murder phase of their plan. They called Taka to the equipment room. And that's where Kifumi killed him, making it the scene of the first murder. The murder weapon was Justice Hammer 4, which was left there in the equipment room. The reason Hammer number 4 was used was to create confusion about the order of the crimes. So, next they falsified 2 more assault incidents. For these attacks, the killers pretended to be the victims to solidify Robo Justice as the suspect. The first fake incident was the attack in the rec room. There, the killers wanted us to see Justice Hammer 1 and the Robo Justice pictures they'd taken. They wanted to make sure we bought the surprise attack story. The second fake incident was the attack in the library. This time, they planted Justice Hammer 2 and an injured Hifumi to sell us that story. With these 2 incidents, the killers were able to create a certain preconception in our minds that the suspect was increasing the size of the hammers and attacking people in order as they did. We fell right into their trap and started looking for the suspect based on that. But... while we did that, we left Hifumi alone in the nurse's office. This was exactly what Hifumi was hoping for. He took a blood packet from the refrigerator and Justice Hammer 3 and turned the room into a crime scene in which he himself had apparently been brutally murdered. He let out a scream to draw us back, and when we returned, that's what we found. Meanwhile, the other group that had been out searching found Taka's body at the same time. So when we heard the body discovery announcement, we naturally assumed it was for Hifumi. We left the nurse's office, and Hifumi once again took advantage of the situation. He simply got up and made his escape. When we learned his body had disappeared, we all rushed back to the nurse's office. And once again, Hifumi had the chance he was waiting for. This time, he snuck into the equipment room. He wrapped Taka's body in a tarp and used the dolly to move it all the way down to the repository. That explains how each of the bodies disappeared. But even Hifumi didn't know what the true killer had in mind for their final act. Their plan all along was to kill Hifumi and get rid of the one person who could betray them. And they did it using an ordinary, everyday hammer from the repository. That should cover everything that happened in this case. And the villain behind it all is... Celeste! Sorry, you lose.
I lost? When was the last time I was forced to utter such words? They hang heavy around my neck.
Then you admit it? You're the killer?
Listen to you, trying to take charge, as if you're my private instructor. I, Celestia Ludenberg. Actually, no. Taiko Yasuhiro is fine.
Taiko?
So, you finally accepted it.
I'm the kind of person, once I've lost, I don't like things to drag on.
Interesting.
Got another one. That's my results of case 3. Now for the ending.
Okay, Monokuma. I'm ready to begin. Or, no. I suppose this is the end, isn't it?
It is indeed the moment we've all been waiting for. Time to vote, okay? Okay. If you would, please locate your lever and cast your vote. And when the votes are tallied, who will become the blackened? Will you make the right choice or the dreadfully wrong one? What's it gonna be? What's it gonna be?
It's basically a formality at this point, but once again, you're totally correct! The black in this time, the true killer to devise the whole stinking scheme was... Celestia Ludenberg! Or more precisely, Taiko Yasuhiro! Ooh, excuse me.
Honestly.
I lost. Well, that sucks. I guess trying to work with someone else was a mistake after all. Hifumi's ineptitude was beyond all my calculations.
I knew
so it. So you really did approach Hifumi with this plan. But how did you get him to agree? I can imagine he could have happily agreed to commit murder. I'm sure he relied on her specialty. I'm sure she relied on her specialty. Lying. My specialty? Don't make me laugh. I didn't have to lie to get him to agree.
So then.
Did you use, you know? I knew you'd figure it out, Kyoko. You're absolutely right. To get Hifumi to act as my accomplice, I used her. For anyone who's still left, I'll avoid mentioning it by name, but... it was the one thing Hifumi and Taka were both super into. Does she mean... she's talking about alter ego?
Say what?
What are you talking about? Your face.
Just a second. Don't interrupt. We're in the middle of a very important conversation here. I'm totally out of the loop, as usual. How sad. And you're the one that stole it.
Indeed.
That's right.
I see.
And use it to drag Ifumi into the plan you'd come up with. Right again. Last night, after we had our meeting about how it disappeared, I paid Ifumi a little visit. What are you going to do here? What are you doing here?
Actually,
I was hoping I could talk to you. Alone. It's about what was stolen. I know who did it.
What?
It was Taka. He stole it. What?
So then.
And I have proof. Would you like to see it? It turned out I found a use for the digital camera. I take it you know what to Taka's room earlier and took pictures of it there. I deleted the picture as soon as I'd shown it to Ifumi, of course.
Damnation!
So it was him! But how did he do it? He was supposed to yell if either of us got close to her! You are correct. Which is why Taka forced me to steal it.
Say what?
What? I'm gonna miss that.
As for me,
please forgive me. He threatened me.
Oh.
He did?
As for me,
he came to my room last night unannounced, and then it's hard for me to even say. He abused me.
What?
And he took pictures. He said if I did not do as he asked, he would show them to everyone. So I had no choice.
Damnation.
That's a crime! An absolute crime! I knew he's getting a little crazy, but... I never imagined he would go that far! It was amazing how we completely bought it. I can't express how enjoyable that was. I'm about to say something I've never said before in my life. I'm going to kill him. I'm going to fucking kill him.
Most unfortunate.
Wait, please. Go now. You'll be playing right into his hands.
Actually,
Taka's planning to use her to escape. And he has made you his target.
What?
Escape, you don't mean. Taka's going to try and kill you. What?
Indeed.
And also he can keep her to himself.
Bastard!
Honestly.
Can we allow him to continue with these barbaric acts? Absolutely not. How could I? She.
I swear.
I have to save her.
Actually,
then would you like to join with me? It just so happens I've come up with a plan. Huh? I've devised a way to reclaim what he has stolen and escape this dreadful school. Now that, it is complete. What are you talking about? Oh, nothing. Ifumi agreed without a second thought. The effect that I had on him was remarkable. The power of love, even a love as twisted as that, can still drive people mad, it would seem. You disgust me!
I
have another question for you. Was that strange costume Hifumi's creation?
Indeed.
Yeah, it was a real pain in the butt, too. All it has to do was make something to hide the face and general body size. I had no idea he'd make something like that.
It's my fault for picking him in the first place.
But...
So why'd you decide to make me the suspect? Because you're stupid. Huh? That's it? Look at your first name and her last name, dummy.
Let's see.
In that regard, I made the right choice. I'm so glad your stupidity surpassed my every expectation. Life must have been tough on your parents, though. I feel like I could cry! Well, when you're explaining your plan to Ifumi, how did you explain the part about him playing dead? What she's asking is, what was Ifumi supposed to do after that, assuming you'd actually let him live?
Are you okay with this?
That's simple. After he did his part and pretended to be dead, when someone showed up, I told him to say he'd been seriously wounded. He was on the verge of death, but he just barely held on. And you really believe that? Well, of course. That wasn't all there was to it. As I explained to Ifumi, the plan was... While you were all questioning him about what had happened to him, I was going to murder someone else. At that point, Ifumi would have an alibi, so nobody could doubt him. I told him that, and he believed it. It all seems very straightforward. Stereotypical. I just matched the lie to the level of the opponent. In fact, Ifumi ate it up. He believed the lie wholeheartedly right up until the moment of his death.
So in the end...
So you had planned to kill him all along! But, of course, there had been no point to my plan if the one who pretended to be dead did not end up dead himself.
How can
human life mean so little to you?
Well,
that's a non-issue. I simply did everything in my power to win.
Don't be mean!
Now you sound like Byakuya!
I wonder
no.
about that.
No, he derives his pleasure from the thrill of the hunt. In that aspect, we are nothing alike.
Why?
Then, what made you take things this far?
Was
it really just for money?
Hmm.
Are you talking about the $10 million Makuma offered us? It is a lot of money, it's true. That's not really all there is to it. From the moment our new life here began, my only thought has been escape.
But
all along you've been saying how we have to accept living here!
You little bitch!
Obviously that was a lie! Yeah.
Hey.
I couldn't take it! I hated it from day one! More than anyone! Anyone else in here! I wanted to get out! Every day was fresh torture! And you wanna know why? Huh?
This is
because I had a dream. Accepting a life here would have meant nothing less than giving up on my dream forever.
Honestly.
There's no way that I could ever do that. In the underground world of gambling, I risked my life to make a metaphorical killing.
And
it was all for that dream. And what was this dream of yours? To live in a European castle. A castle? And to gather handsome men from all over the world to serve as my butlers / bodyguards. I was going to make them dress up like vampires and satisfy my every need. Once I obtained that, I've created a perfectly aesthetic world of decadence.
This is fine.
Living the rest of my life there was my only dream. My only goal. That's what life is all about! Combined with my own winnings, Monokuma's $10 million would have made that dream a reality. I got right to the edge, but...
There is
unfortunately, my dream has become scattered to the wind. Still, I don't have any regrets. I pursued my dream to the very end. So why would I?
Just the worst!
You sound so passionate, but you really were able to kill your own friends for it?
Oh.
You're asking me to feel guilty. That's a pointless endeavor. I think nothing is sacrificing others for my own ends. I feel nothing.
Do you understand?
That's all there is to me. That's what makes me... complete. Isn't it terrifying how different our values are? There's simply no room for understanding.
What is this?
That's what we should be saying, and plus... How can you be so calm?
Don't you realize you're about to die? Why aren't you scared? My ability to lie is unrivaled. I take pride in that. It's not just for other people. I can even fool my own emotions. The consciousness deceives the unconscious. And that's why you're not scared?
Yes,
yeah, that's right. Don't fear death. Kill me however you like. But you know, if I could be reincarnated, if I had a choice then... I think I'd like to come back as Marie Antoinette. Hey. You just get executed again! Celeste smiled then. And when she did, it looked to me like a poor effort to force it. She claimed she could fool her own feelings. That statement itself must have been her final lie. And that weak, fake smile is what betrayed her. You all done? Okay, then let's get rolling. The Black and the Third to peace, I must pay the price!
Now then, I've prepared a very special punishment!
For her! The ultimate gambler!
Let's give it everything we've got! It's punishment time!
I guess I'll let Kyoko hold on to this. What?
This is...
Will it really give you the hope you're looking for? I can't say I ever saw it that way. Which is why... Actually, it's not important. Well then, take care, everyone. Perhaps we'll meet again in another life.
It's over. Third execution is over. Celeste's death is over. Celeste killed my friend, so I can't pity her, but I liked her. Your friends, close friends. I was in her room. I also can't deny that at one point I considered her a friend too. It just hurts. And for him to just come along and... Isn't it just awful? Someone couldn't cut free of their regrets from the outside world, and so more people had to die.
Extreme!
You guys are still young! You need to place more value in your lives! On your lives, whatever.
What are you gonna do?
Jeez, and here I thought you guys were gonna pass the torch of hope to the next generation! What do I care about hope? I'll throw it in the trash if you just let me out of here.
Too bad.
You're all the embodiment of hope, whether you like it or not. It's my destiny to knock you down one by one. It's sad. Yes, it is. But that reality just can't be avoided. Don't talk like you're not responsible. How are you gonna make us keep going through this? What do you want from us?
How strange.
God, I'm so sick of people asking me that. Give it a rest already. So, anyway, Kyoko, did I see you get some kind of key type object from Celeste?
Hey.
So, what's the deal with that? Huh? What's the matter?
So then,
I'll answer your question if you answer mine. What did you do? What did you do to me? What?
Hey.
Answer me. What did you do to my body? Oh man. Oh jeez. Oh man. Oh jeez. What do you mean? What did I do? I have no idea. I don't know anything about it. What was that just now? Mastermind did something to Kyoko's body? What does that mean?
Hello.
Okay, things are just getting kind of awkward. I think it's about time I got out of here.
Well?
Meanwhile, you guys can go on enjoying your school life. Get lonely, give me a shout. Not that I'll do anything about it, of course.
See ya.
See ya! My Akuma disappeared, leaving us all depressed and in despair. Although it wasn't all despair, there was one small hope. Hey, Kyoko, my Akuma already mentioned it, but what's that key Celeste gave you?
So,
most likely, it's the key to one of the dressing room lockers.
Huh?
What? Then that means Celeste probably hid it in there.
Hey.
I suppose sometimes it's easiest to miss what's right beneath your nose. Well then, we'd better go check.
Indeed.
Good idea. We left the courtroom and rushed to the dressing room. As we approached the dressing room, Kyoko looked back at us and said,
"Hey,
I'm going on alone from here. Everyone else head to the dining hall. I'll check in with you later."
What?
Why exactly are you going alone?
So,
do you even have to ask? As she spoke, she glanced quickly at the surveillance camera.
Come on.
That's not what I mean. Why you? There's still a risk of a spy, you know. Then I'll go too. You? Please, let me go. Jerk. Staying here arguing is just going to draw more attention to us.
Goodbye.
Do whatever you want. Thank you, Byakuya. Pain in the...
Well, then.
It's up to you now.
Yo.
I'm gonna go to the dining hall, okay? Huh? So we go, Kyoko, are gonna go together? Does that mean what you think it means?
Okay.
Good luck, Makoto. Girls like her are total pushovers and show a little backbone. I tried to forget what Hina said. Everyone headed to the dining hall, leaving me and Kyoko there alone.
Shall we go?
Well, shall we? Yeah.
So then,
we need to get into that locker. Kyoko took the key Celeste had given her and locked the locker. I stared at her all day, and as the locker swung open, we saw...
You're really pale.
Good morning. It's been a while, hasn't it? It's safe. Thank goodness. I never heard Kyoko sound so relieved. It was like she was speaking from the bottom of her heart. I did just what Celeste asked. I didn't say a word. I stayed quiet the entire time.
So,
oh, and... I think I may be able to open the last set of files soon. Maybe as early as tomorrow. I'm doing my best, so please wait just a little while longer. So now I can officially say the case is closed. As far as this incident is concerned, sure, but... Let me take a second since we had this opportunity. Why don't you be honest with me? Do you actually love me? Kyoko, please tell me. What are you trying to do all on your own here at the school?
You.
Is that why you want to come in here with me?
However.
Regardless, that's not something you need to know right now. Well, that Miyake was a bitch, but I don't need to know. That just makes me even more worried.
What?
Worried? Like, what happened to our investigation this time? You disappeared. We didn't see you again. I don't care about you. That warning. That explanation. When you do that, I get scared.
Indeed.
It's only natural that they think I'm the mastermind spy, right? And you too. No! I love you, girl! No! I believe in you!
What?
You believe in me? We hung out so much, I love you! Isn't it obvious? People believe in their friends, right? And that's why I want you to tell me. I want you to believe in me too. Because we're friends. Possibly lovers. I understand.
It's true.
Then, maybe I can believe in you. Just a little bit more. Then...
That's fine.
Fine. I'll tell you. I'll tell you why I've been disappearing and where I've been going. You see... What I heard from Kyoko then was... Well, frankly, it kind of blew my mind. Right after I told Kyoko, I believe in her. She told me a story that was, well, almost unbelievable. So I had to confirm what she told me with my own two eyes, so I waited for nighttime to come. You know, it is nighttime already, and when it did, I went into action.
Correct.
The boys' bathroom on the second floor doesn't have a surveillance camera or monitor in it. In the storage closet there. Way in the back. She said it was way in the back of the boys' storage closet, but... Could Kyoko really be right about this? Only one way to find out. Besides using the map. Door. Okay. In the back. Just a normal storage closet as far as I can tell. You don't see the outline though. The secret Kyoko told me about. Could it really be hidden there? Well, here? Let's find out. He said it was way in the back of the storage closet. I mean, seriously? Well, then I placed my hand in the back of the storage closet. Then suddenly, as if I were being yanked in... Geshunk! Same time I heard that sound, I fell through the wall. I had no idea what was going on. Ba-bump! I had fallen through the back of the storage closet. Huh? It turned out... The back of the wall was like a revolving door. I'd made my way to the other side. Just like Kyoko had said.
Correct.
In the boys' bathroom on the second floor, there's a storage closet. In the way back of that closet, there's a secret room. So this is the secret room. But what's in here? Not much. Let's check this stool out. It's just a normal desk with normal drawers. There's a bunch of files and what looks like a volume after volume of yearbooks. They're all covered in dust. Looking at everything, one file at the edge of the bookshelf caught my eye. Cosby Academy Student Registry. It's the only thing in here not covered in dust. Has someone been looking at it recently? I slipped the file into my hand.
Before I had a chance to take a look at it, a slip of paper fell out of the file and I turned my attention to it. What's this? You must not leave? That's kind of weird. I can understand if it said, like, I can't leave, but you must not leave? What is this? My head feels funny. A strange sensation. It's like deja vu. Those words, you must not leave. I've seen them somewhere before. But I can't quite remember. What do I know? What don't I know? I... A strange sound rang out through my head. Felt like it was shaking my brain back and forth. And then, darkness. I don't understand what's happening. I don't know what started it. It's all over. With that, I opened my eyes. Didn't know how long it had been. Ow! Apparently something hit me and I lost consciousness. That's all I understood. The dull, throbbing pain in my head proved that much at least. An empty bookshelf. Huh? Empty? Gone! It's all gone! Yearbooks, the student registry, and even a note that had fallen on the floor. It's all gone? What does this mean? My brain refused to do any more work. The insistent pain in my head began to spread across the rest of my body. But for now, I should go back to my room. Get some rest. Maybe take some Tylenol on the way. Or something. My body was heavy with pain, my mind heavy with thought. I dragged myself back toward my room. Somehow I made it back to the first floor of the school. Further I walked, the more I felt. Things are getting blurry. Can't see in front of me. I couldn't stop myself from collapsing right there. And after that... Huh? As if from a vast distance, I heard a sound. So bad you can barely hear it. It was faint, but undeniable. That sound. It's coming from the gym? As I desperately hauled my shaky frame toward the gym, the sound got stronger and stronger. What's going on? It can't be nothing. Here? In the gym? Might as well check it out. I didn't make a sound as I opened the door to the gym. The sounds coming from inside me, while only intensified that much more. Before me, the rage of battle beyond anything humanly possible. One side's not human, that's for sure, but regardless, I couldn't stop staring. Forgot to move, or even breathe.
Why, you? What do you think you're doing? I asked you a question. What's the meaning of this? How dare you defy me? This wasn't part of the deal!
The deal?
I've made a decision. I will no longer retreat, no longer compromise, no longer regret. I've made my decision. I'm going to resist you.
Okay. But you do realize what will happen if you go through with this, right? You haven't forgotten, have you? What I'm holding hostage?
What am I looking at? What am I hearing? A hostage? Then, could it be? Mesmerized Spy is... Chapter 3. Next Generation Legends, Stand Tall Collected Hero. The end. Flying Students, 7. To be continued. You received the Super Robo Justice Present! I'm getting the episode here. I'll see you on the next episode for Chapter 4. 3's a crowd get. See you then. I just want to go over a couple things with Celeste's execution real quick. Let me get the book and go to the page that I should have saved, and... yes, I did save. It is right here. During the actual execution... well, during the study execution, when you're sitting at the stage, you might have noticed a rabbit hanging from the top of the actual place where she was going to get burned from the actual stage. This is actually a beta element that they were going to use as a prop for her that she was going to carry with her the whole time. It was going to be a toy bunny. Therefore, adding a little bit to the execution factor itself. It's a very, you know, very old-fashioned execution. Burn the witch at the stake, even though we didn't do that apparently in Salem. We apparently hung them, if you actually studied the actual thing. Except for Giles, who wanted more weight. As for... at the end... the fire truck? That's more than just what you think. It's actually because Teiko really hated being a commoner. She didn't like it. So she made this whole persona being this royal Victorian whatever, French whatever, whatever you want to call it. And she was in that persona the whole time. So execution was in her persona until the truck came. The truck hit her and killed her. She died like a commoner. The one thing she hated being. Does that strike you at all as brilliance on Monokuma here? Because that's how evil this guy is. He is an ass. But his executions, when you look at him behind the scenes, holy shoot. I was said something I didn't want to say because technically we aren't on the actual game, so. But yeah, he hits the nail right on the head. I hope you have fun. I'll see you next time for Chapter 4. See you then.